بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر، إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا. ومن الليل فتهجد اهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما محمودا. أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج صدق واجعل لي من لدنك سلطانا وقل جاء الحق وزهق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهوقا. وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا. وإذا أنعمنا على الإنسان أعرض ونأى بجانبه وإذا مسه الشر كان يئوسا. قل كل يعمل على شاكلته فربكم أعلم بمن هو أهدى سبيلا. ويسألونك عن الروح قل الروح من أمر ربي وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليلا. صدق الله العظيم.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm glad to welcome everybody to our Al-Ghazali event, which is going to be brought to you by Dawud Arba. For the beautiful planning institution. Just to give you a quick rundown of the day, inshallah we'll be starting the course with the life of Imam Ghazali, followed by a section of knowledge from his Ihya ul-Mubin. That will last until 12 o'clock. There will be a break for 2 hours. We'll be praying Dhuhr, and there will be refreshments inshallah. And we'll resume session at 2 and we'll finish at 5. In the second session, we'll be looking into the book of Breaking on the Ihya ul-Mubin, Breaking the Two Desires. And inshallah, if time permits, and we're also going to a section of Aqeedah from the Ihya ul-Mubin. Just to give you a quick introduction about the Shaykh, who's going to deliver the course. Shaykh Zakariya al-Siddiqi al-Jazairi was born in a noble scholarly family and memorized the Quran at a very young age, at the age of 9. He studied the traditional Islamic sciences with scholars in Algeria, and later on went to Egypt, where he studied at Al-Azhar University for 10 years. He has an MA in the Principles of Islamic Jurisprudence and has recently completed a PhD at the University of Sorbonne in France. He is also the former Dean of the Faculty of Quranic Studies and Professor of Islamic Jurisprudence at the European Institute of Islamic Sciences in France. Sheikh Zakariya is also a member of the International Union of Muslim Scholars. Without going on much further, inshallah, get over to Sheikh Zakariya.
Sheikh started with sending praise upon Allah Azza wa Jal, and he mentioned that the praise upon Allah Azza wa Jal should be for the duration of all time and in all conditions and in all states. Therefore, he sent his verses and salutations upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and that our salutations upon the Prophet should also be with the connection of the duration of all times. And therefore, he made a du'a that Allah Azza wa Jal give us the sincerity for seeking knowledge and any type of knowledge, and also Allah Azza wa Jal opened upon us the doors of understanding, and opened upon us the doors of understanding of the essence of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and to proceed.
إن من نعم الله عز وجل على العبد أن يعرفه بأحبابه وبمن يستخدمهم لحمل ميراث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهم العلماء، فإما أن يصحبهم في حياتهم أو بعد مماتهم، يصحبهم في حياتهم حين يلقاهم فيجلس إليهم ويستفيد من علمهم، وبعد مماتهم بأن يدرس تراثهم و وما خلفوه من أعمال جليلة نفع الله بها من شاء من خلفه.
Sheikh proceeded to mention that the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla upon his faith is that we should be aware of who the Ahbab or the beloved people of Allah Azza wa Jalla are. And without doubt, the beloved of Allah Azza wa Jalla are the ulama. And from the ulama, the ones that are alive, we should spend our time with them, learning from them, benefiting from their estates, benefiting from their the sayings and benefiting from their knowledge and character. And thereafter, we also have ulama that have passed to the mercy of Allah. Those who have died and gone to Allah Azza wa Jal. Those can also benefit from them. And how is that? You can benefit from them by studying their legacy and the heritage which they have left behind, from their writings, from their lives, from their wisdoms, from their books, and that which they have left behind from the actions, which is their writings. So Allah Azza wa Jalla desires from us that we know Him through knowing His beloved, which are the ulama, thereafter from the ones that are living, and thereafter if once they have gone from those that have passed away by studying their heritage, and by the best of us studying their heritage, is gathering such as this, which we will inshallah try to understand one of the greatest scholars of our deen.
وجد الإسلام أبي حامد الغزالي رحمه الله من هذا الباب، فلم نتشرف ببعد الزمان بصحبته في حياته، ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى أنعم علينا بوصول مؤلفاته ونخب من أخباره وسيرته عن طريق ما دونه هو وتلامذته، فمعرفتنا به وصحبتنا له جاءتنا من هذا العلم المنتفع به الذي لا ينقطع من عمل الإنسان، من قال عليه الصلاة والسلام إذا مات ابن آدم انقطع عمله إلا من ثلاث: علم ينتفع به، وصدقة جارية، وولد صالح يرثه.
The Sheikh proceeded to mention that from the ulama that have gone to the mercy of Allah and have passed from this life to the next, we have Imam al-Ghazali, Allah. And Imam al-Ghazali, also known by the title Hujjat al-Islam, the proof of Islam, is one of the foremost of the scholars. And we are very lucky in that after the passing of his time, his legacy still remains with us in two ways. First, by the legacy of his works, the works which he has left behind, and also the legacy of his own life. And we have a lot of detail about his life left by himself in his own works, and also left by and recorded by his students. So the knowledge which this Imam has left behind is knowledge which is of beneficial and continuously beneficial. And this returns back to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which Shaykh mentioned, saying that all of the actions of Ibn Adam, of the sons of Adam, end except for three. One by which there's continuous charity, then there is a child that prays for their parents, and then there is knowledge which is benefited by.
حين ننظر إلى واقعنا اليوم من سهولة الوصول إلى الكتب المؤلفات، بل المكتبات جعلت الآن في أقراص ليزر متناولة على الأرصفة وعلى الطرق، كل يستطيع أن ينالها ويحصل عليها. ونرجع إلى أيام أبي حامد الغزالي رحمه الله حين كان الكتاب عزيزا، حين كانت النسخة من الكتاب تقتنى بشق الأنفس بصعوبة، وكيف أن الناس اغتنموا أوقاتهم وانتفعوا بها حتى تركوا لنا من المؤلفات والكتب ما نعجز اليوم عن قراءته لا عن تأليفه.
And if we look into our realities today and the situation today, we find that for us to reach books, for us to procure books, is a very easy operation. Today we can go to the libraries, and the libraries are full of books that have been written by our scholars. And even easier than that, a person can get one laser CD or compact disc. And with complete ease, return back to the writings of our previous scholars. This is in contradiction or in comparison to the time of the past, when every book was considered to be prized possession. Because obviously, although printing in the past, the books were written by Musaf, by writers. And so books were in the past difficult to get. But today we notice that the books are available, the titles are available, and we sometimes wonder how the scholars were able in the short lifespan which they had to write with such a huge amount of writings, huge amount of works. But in addition to that, we also understand how was it possible for the ulama to write certain books which even today we are still finding extremely difficult to understand and to read.
كيف لرجل لم يقضي من العمر في هذه الدنيا إلا 55 سنة أن يترك كل هذه المؤلفات مع كثرة السفر وصعوبة الوسائل، وليس فقط الذي يثير الانتباه هو كثرة المؤلفات، ولكن نوعية هذه المؤلفات، الإبداع في التأليف، التجديد في التأليف. فلا شك أن الذي ينقل عن غيره يكون عمله أسهل من ذاك الذي يأتي بأفكار جديدة، تنبيهات، إشارات لا يتفطن إليها جل الناس. فهذا يحتاج إلى عمق تفكير وإلى نظر غير ممنوح لكثيرين. وصنيع أبي حامد الغزالي رحمه الله من هذا القبيل.
Hear how Imam al-Ghazali did not spend in this life a long time, rather it was a short time, the duration of only 55 years, which was the duration of his life. He left behind a huge library of his works. And this was in addition to his traveling, this was in addition to his teaching commitments, this was in addition to all of the other commitments which he had being a teacher. But that's not only the number and the huge quantity of what he left behind, but also the nawa'iyah, also the type and the quality of what he left behind. He left behind not only books which were collated from works of previous people that came before him, rather he left behind works which were original and which were unique, and in which he was a pioneer in that particular type of writing. So he left behind works which other people built upon after he left, and these works point towards a new topic which were untouched by previous authors, and this points to the depth of his understanding and his thinking into the Islamic sciences.
لم يعش إلا 55 سنة، لكن هذا بحساب المسلمين يعني بالسنة القمرية، وإلا فبحساب الشائع اليوم الحساب الميلادي فعاش 53 سنة رحمه الله. هو ولد على الراجح رحمه الله عام 450 من الهجرة الموافق ل 58 بعد المئة العاشرة بعد الألف، وتوفي عام 505 من الهجرة الموافق ل 1111 للميلاد، وما بين 505 وما بين 450 إلى 505 سجل اسمه رحمه الله على كتاب من نور باق إلى يوم القيامة إن شاء الله بفضل الجهد والصدق في ما قدم بين يدي الله عز وجل. وسنتناول هذه المدة الزمنية التي عاشها رحمه الله 53 أو 55 سنة، سنحاول أن نتلمس ملامحها لنتعرف أكثر على هذا الإمام وعلى تجربته إن شاء الله.
We must not forget that 55 years which we mentioned is not 55 solar years, but 55 lunar years. So the duration actually less than 55. It's approximately as close to 53 or 53 years. So in the short span of this time, he left behind vast quantities of work, and he passed away approximately, most authentic of reports, is 505 after Hijri, which corresponds to 1111 Miladi. From what
was it?
From 450. And he was born 450 after Hijri. And due to his sincerity, and due to the truth of his inner intentions, and due to the clarity of his vision to please Allah, he was able to touch on many topics, and we, within this short time that we have on this time which Allah has apportioned for us, will look into the life of this person who lived approximately 53 years in Jaluna and 55 according to the Sahara.
يمكن أن نقسم هذه السنوات على أربع مراحل. مرحلة النشأة والاستفادة، ومرحلة تخمر وتفاعل مكوناته العلمية، ومرحلة ثالثة مرحلة الشك ومراجعة ونقد تجربته السابقة المرحلتين، والمرحلة الأخيرة والرابعة هي مرحلة تجديد وإعادة صياغة الإنسان والمعرفة ونظرياتها وتقديمه لمشروع متكامل ينطلق من فهم عميق للوحي.
We divide the Imam's life into four major periods. The first of which is his growth and development, his intellectual growth as well as bodily and spiritual growth. That was during the time of initially receiving knowledge first within his own region, thereafter his travels for seeking knowledge in other parts of the Islamic world. Thereafter, the second stage is his period of maturity, his his intellectual maturity, where he became the head teacher of one of the famous colleges, which we'll talk about later. And during that period, following that, we have the period of his doubt, the period of his self-doubt and his intellectual crisis and his spiritual crisis, in which he feared for himself, and his fear of entering into the hellfire. He did not make some changes. And therefore, the final period, after he had a period of doubt and intellectual crisis, where he re-understood the whole religion in its entirety, and he had a totally new, you could say, almost project or totally new understanding of the deen, and then his attempts to internalize that and write about that and to make this something for which the Muslims could also adhere to.
المرحلة الأولى وهي من ولادته سنة 1850 إلى أن يبلغ سن 28 من عمره، هذه هي المرحلة التي يمكن أن نصفها بمرحلة التكوين والتحصيل والاستفادة العلمية. أبو حامد الغزالي رحمه الله، كثير من الناس يتساءل من أين جاءه هذا الاسم. من المنقول المعروف أن والده كان غزالا للصوف، يغزل الصوف، ومن هنا قيل له غزالي، أي نسبة إلى هذه الصناعة، صناعة غزل الصوف. وكان والده أميا، لم يكن من العلماء ولكنه كان يحب العلم ويحب الصالحين، وكان الصوفية في ذلك الوقت هم من يعرفون بالالتزام الصادق بالإسلام في معانيه الخالصة. فكان أبوه إذن من الصوفية المحبين للعلم وأهله، ولما حضرته الوفاة أوصى صديقا له كذلك، يعني من المتصوفة، بولدي، كان عنده أحمد ومحمد، وأخذ عليه عهدا أن يعلمهما، قائلا له: إن لي تأسفا عظيما على تعلم الخط، وأشتهي استدراك ما فاتني في ولدي هذين، فعلمهما، ولا عليك أن تنفذ في ذلك جميع ما أخلفه لهما، أي لو صرفت لأجل تعليمهما كل ما أخلفه من مال فلا حرج عليك، افعل ذلك، المهم أن يتعلم، لا حاجة بالمال إذا لم ينفع صاحبه في الدنيا والآخرة.
So turning back to the first period of those four periods which we talked about earlier, from the birth of Imam Ghazali, 450 after Hijri, the first initial 18 years was the time of his procurement and learning of knowledge. The first thing was returned back is, where did your name Al-Ghazali? Where did your name Al-Ghazali come from? The origins returns back to his father. The origin returns back to his father. His father was Al-Ghazali, which means a person who used to weave wool. And because of that, because of the trade which his father had, his name was also passed down to his son. His father was illiterate in that he did not know how to read or write, but he used to love the people of knowledge and love knowledge. And he was a pious person and a person who used to keep the company and used to be associated with people of Tazkiyah or of Tasawwuf. And he used to have a close friend, which he used to keep close in his daily life. And this person was also like Ibn Ghazali's father, from the people of Tazkiyah, people of purification and Tasawwuf. When death came near to Ibn Ghazali's father, he told this person that I have two sons. Muhammad, who was Ibn Ghazali, and his brother Ahmed. And he gave him a bequeath to him, his will, that he said that I regret tremendously the fact of not being able to read or write and not having studied. I want my children not to be in the same state in which I was. So all the wealth which I have left behind, it is of no consequence to me. All the wealth is expended and used in spending for their to education. And this is the will which his father left behind in regard to his two sons, Muhammad and Ahmed.
إذن أول معلم في حياتي الغزالي رحمه الله وفي حياة أخي أحمد هو صديق والدهما هذا الصوفي الذي تعاهدهما بالرعاية وسعى إلى تعليمهما. وهذا الأمر لا شك له أثر في نفسية الإمام أبي حامد الغزالي، وإن لم يعلن عن نفسه هذا التأثر إلا في مرحلة متأخرة حين استقر وظهر الشك في حياته. ولكن هذه البذرة الأولى لن تذهب هباء. ولكن هذا الرجل الذي لا نعرف عنه الكثير سيتوقف لقلة المال عن متابعة المهمة وتنفيذ الوصية، ويبعث بالولدين أحمد ومحمد إلى مدرسة لطلبة العلم تكون هي الكفيل بتعلمهم، فتتحمل عنه التبعات المالية في تعليم هذين الولدين. نعم.
So this is the first teacher of both Muhammad and Ahmed. What's this same person we spoke about just a moment ago? And there's no doubt that this first teacher had an effect on the very nature and essence of Imam al-Ghazali, even if it was not perceived at the time. In that, the fact that his first teacher was a person of Tazkiyah and Tasawwuf and Sufism, this was something which would take a deep root in the heart of Imam al-Ghazali. And only later in his last period of his life would that effect of that bear fruition. So due to the lack of resources which were available to the teacher, he was not able to complete their education. He was not able to complete their education. And due to that, he sent them to both Muhammad and Ahmed to a madrasa, to a school within the vicinity, to learn knowledge. And as such, because he was being the kafil or the guardian over those two children after the demise of their father, he saw it fit to send them to his madrasa for them to continue their learning.
تعلم الغزالي الفقه في بلده طوس على أحمد بن محمد الرادكاني ثم سافر إلى جرجان إلى الإمام أبي نصر الإسماعيلي وعلق عنه التعليقة في الفقه ثم رجع إلى طوس وأكمل شيئا من الدراسات هناك وتثبت معظم المصادر حادثة جرت بين الغزالي وبين قطاع طرق أثناء عودته إلى بلده. تروي عن الغزالي أنه قال: قطعت علينا الطريق وأخذ العيارون جميعا معي، فقلت لمقدمهم: أسألك بالذي ترجو السلامة منه أن ترد علي كتبي فقط، هاجرت لسماعها وكتابتها ومعرفة علمها. فضحك وقال: كيف تدعي أنك عرفت علمها وقد أخذناها منك فتجردت من معرفتها وبقيت بلا علم؟ فقال الغزالي: هذا مستنطق أنطقه الله ليرشدني به في أمري. فلما وافى طوس أقبل على الاشتغال 3 سنين حتى حفظ جميع ما دونه وصار علمه جزء عقله لا جزء أوراقه.
الإمام الغزالي رحمه
الله في طوس.
الإمام الغزالي رحمه الله continued his studies and in Tours he studied science of fiqh or jurisprudence with two of the major scholars of that time. Thereafter in Tours he continued his studies and completed his studies with many of the other scholars that were present. And in his return back to Tours, an incident occurred to him which was to change the way in which he viewed his study of knowledge. Narrated that when he returned back by himself, by Imam himself, he was stopped by highwaymen, right? Highwaymen, and going through the contents of what people had on their caravans and on their camels and their horses, they came across the papers of Imam Ghazali, his notes which he had made during his days studying fiqh and the other sciences. So they took this. He took his papers, he took his parchments and his scrolls with all his notes on them. So Imam al-Ghazali went to the leader of those highwaymen. He said, "This is only papers and notes. This is of no benefit to you. This is the knowledge which I have. Please return it back to me." And the person laughed at him and said, "What kind of alim or scholar are you that your knowledge is in the pages and not within your heart?" Imam al-Ghazali was very affected by the saying of this particular highwayman. And he said that this is something which Allah has manifested upon the tongue of this person for my guidance and for my wisdom. So from that point on, he took it upon himself to memorize everything which he had written. And it said that period took him 3 years to memorize everything which he had written on those on his parchment and on his notes for his previous
إذا هذه الحادثة جعلته يفهم ويعي مبكرا قيمة الحفظ في العلم وأن العلم هو الذي يصحب الإنسان في كل أحواله لا الذي يكون في الأوراق حتى إذا ما ضاعت الأوراق من صاحبها عاد جاهلا. وكثير هذه الآفة تظهر اليوم كثيرا، في تجد باحث دكتوراه ولكن علمه كله في أوراقه، إذا لم تكن حاضرة معه لا يعرف إجابة عن سؤال ولا إفادة السامعين.
So we learn from this a very important principle that the value of a scholar is what is in his memory. The value of a scholar is what is in his memory. And a knowledge comes with a person who has it memorized with him wherever he goes. That he has with him is the istihdar, or the presence of his knowledge. So whenever he is asked about a certain question or a topic, he has a response ready to that in most scenarios or situations. This is an illness or a problem of our present societies, in which a person might be a doctor, a specialist in a certain aspect, but if you ask him about any particular issue relating to his specialization, he will not be able to give you a response because all of his notes and all of his information is where? In his pages of his PhD thesis. So, this is an illness of our present times, but this was something Imam Ghazali learned very early on, that knowledge is something which comes with you and retains with you within your memory and your heart, not something that retains on or remains on the pages.
في هذه المرحلة استفاد كما قلنا الفقه والعربية وغيرها من العلوم، ورحل مع جملة من طلبة العلم من بلده طوس إلى نيسابور، حيث كان بها عالم من كبار علماء الإسلام وهو الإمام الجويني رحمه الله. الجويني من مواليد 419، وتوفي رحمه الله سنة 78 و400 من الهجرة، 78 و400 من الهجرة رحمه الله. فجلس إليه يتعلم عنه ويأخذ فوائد وشوارد المسائل منه حتى توفي رحمه الله، يعني لازمه ملازمة حتى قضى الأجل بفك هذه الصحبة. وكان الإمام الجويني يقول: الغزالي بحر مغدق، بحر مغدق، يعني تنبه إلى سعة علمه واطلاعه وإلى نبوغه المبكر، ونحن لم نصل بعد إلى يعني سن متقدمة، ولا يزال لم يكمل 30 من عمره. بعد وفاة الجويني لا نعرف لأبي حامد الغزالي شيخا، إنما بقي يدور ويستفيد ولكن لم يلازم شيخا. فلعله من خلال هذه الكلمة التي قالها الجويني نفهم أنه بلغ الأستاذية وما عاد يحتاج إلى من يفتح له العبارات، فاستقل بنفسه في التحصيل.
So the next period we hear that Imam al-Ghazali left from Tus to Nisaipur, where he sought knowledge from the great imam and scholar of that particular college there, Imam al-Juwayni. He was born in 419, passed away in 417 after Hijri. He took from him the detailed matters of the religion, in the deep matters and unfathomable matters of points of law, and he stayed with this imam. From Ghazali stayed with Imam al-Juwayni till his death. So he gained from him for a long period. And by that time, Imam Ghazali has still not reached 13 in his age, but yet the Imam al-Juwayni, seeing his Imam Ghazali's knowledge, his foresight, his deep understanding of the issues which were discussed between them, he said that he was an unconquerable ocean, that an ocean which had no bed, an ocean which had no bed. And this was still during the time when Imam Ghazali has still not reached 30 of his age, not reached 30 of his age. And one other notable thing about Imam Ghazali rahimahullah was that he did not stick to one particular sheikh, one particular scholar from which he sought from and benefited from. Rather, he had many, many scholars which he used to take different sciences and different knowledges. And from what we can perceive from the statement of Imam al-Juwayni is the fact that he must have reached a level of ustadiyya or a level of perfection or the knowledge of competency very, very early on. Very early on. To the extent that he, Imam Ghazali himself, used to return to the sources and return to the books and return to the writings of scholars of past and present and take from them directly through the means of their books, which are the level of which he had reached that short amount of time.
المرحلة الثانية تبدأ من بلوغ سن 28 إلى سن 38.
The second period is the period from the age of approximately 28 to the age of 38, the second period which we spoke about, which was his maturing in his intellectual sciences.
العلاقة بين الأستاذ والتلميذ هي الطريق التي طورها العلماء المسلمون في نقل المعرفة. فكما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال في حديث جبريل في آخر هذا جبريل جاء يعلمكم دينكم حيث قدم إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وجلس إليه وضع يديه على ركبتيه هذه الطريقة في الجلوس ثم في السؤال وما إلى ذلك هذه العلاقة بين الأستاذ و الطالب والتلميذ حافظ عليها العلماء في نقل المعرفة والغزالي رحمه الله ليس بدعا وإنما مشى على هذا النهج وعلى هذه الطريقة وتعلم كذلك كما رأينا حين لازم الجويني رحمه الله ثم حين استقل بنفسه احتاج إلى أن ينتقل إلى محل يكون فيه أهل العلم أكثر عددا و فسافر رحمه الله إلى المعسكر قاصدا الوزير نظام الملك الذي كان يحب العلماء ويكرم العلماء وكان مجلسه معروفا بأنه مجمع لأهل العلم يعني يجتمع كثيرون من أهل العلم ليناقشوا المسائل فوصل إلى المعسكر وبدأ يحضر هذه المجالس ويناظر الأئمة في هذه المجالس ويناقش حتى ظهر علمه وشهدوا له بالتفوق واعترفوا بفضله حينئذ لقي التعظيم والتكريم من الوزير نظام الملك
Thank you. So during this period of between 28 and 38 of his age, the age of his intellectual maturity, Imam Ghazali rahimahullah continued in the same way as was mentioned by the scholars of the past and the same methodology of scholars of the past, in that he had total renovation respect for his teachers. And this was what's come to us from the famous hadith of the Gabriel of the Jibril hadith, in which Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ibn alayhi salam, how they took the position of the teacher and the student, and how Ibn alayhi salam sat with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, connected his knees to the knees of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and total reverential respect how he spoke to him. And this other was continued by Imam Ghazali with his immediate and first major teacher Ibn Jumaydi. And this continued when he went to meet other scholars and went to other areas to seek and gain knowledge. And he also traveled to a famous personality of the time, Nizam al-Mulk, who was a ruler of a region of that time. And he went to that particular school, and his gatherings were famous because he was a person who loved the people of knowledge and the people of letters and arts. And whenever anybody went to his gatherings, they would find within those gatherings the leaders of all the particular sciences and arts of that time. So when Imam Ghazali went to that place, Mu'asbar, he was very welcomed there, and he discussed and debated with, issues with the scholars that were present at that gatherings, at the gathering of Nizam al-Mulk. And very quickly it became apparent to the other scholars that were present there of the depth of this person's understanding and the depth of his knowledge and the exactness of his understanding on all the major principles. And very quickly his position within that particular gathering became a gathering from a student to one of a teacher and to one of who was now from considered from the Mutafawwid, for the people that were deemed to be the leaders of the particular gathering there. And based upon that, he was elevated in the eyes and in the heart of the people of that time, in particular Nizam al-Mulk himself.
حين بلغ هذه المنزلة في عين نظام الملك ولاه التدريس في مدرسته ببغداد، المدرسة النظامية، وأمره بالتوجه إليها سنة 84، كان عمر الغزالي حينئذ 34 سنة، إذن صار أستاذا في أعظم مدرسة في ذلك الوقت وعمره 34 سنة. فدرس الغزالي في النظامية حتى أعجب به أهل العراق بحسن كلامه وفصاحة لسانه وإشاراته الدقيقة وأحبوه. ويروي أبو بكر بن العربي الفقيه المالكي الأندلسي، وهو من تلامذة حامد الغزالي بن جباء، أنه قال: رأيت الإمام الغزالي ببغداد يحضر مجلس درسه نحو 400 عمامة من أكابر الناس وأفاضلهم يأخذون عنه العلم.
So Nizam al-Mulk, being very impressed by the caliber of Imam Ghazali, made him the chief instructor of Madrasa of Nizamiya, which was based in Baghdad. And this was in the year 480 after Hijri, when Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah, was only 34 years of age, 34 years of age. So at such a young age of 34, he died the chief instructor of one of the most prestigious and largest madrasas, schools, seminaries at that time. And the people of Iraq were extremely impressed and taken aback by him. And people from all over the region traveled to study with him and to study within his institution. Abu Bakr ibn Arabi, the famous Faqih al-Maliki, the famous famous scholar of fiqh from the school of the Malikiyah, from Maliki Madhab, he says, and he was from one of the famous students of Imam al-Ghazali, he mentioned that when a person used to go to the gatherings of Imam al-Ghazali, the teaching circles of Imam al-Ghazali, he used to see there more than 400 of the leaders and the imams of the people. So this tells you something about the status and the knowledge of Imam al-Ghazali. 400 of the scholars of the highest caliber repute used to attend his circles.
بعد عام من تدريس الغزالي بالنظامية في بغداد، أي حوالي عام 85 و400 من الهجرة، قتل شاب من الباطنية، فرقة ضالة، نظام الملك الوزير. وبعد عام أو أكثر أفتى الغزالي يوسف بن تاشفين حقه في عزل الأمراء العصاة، بفتوى التي كان يعتمد عليها يوسف بن تاشفين في عزل سلاطين السوء والأمراء الظالمين والأمراء الفاسقين العصاة. كان المفتي هو أبو حامد الغزالي. و أذكر هذا لأنبه على أنه كان ذا صلة بالسلطان، بالحكام، لم يكن منعزلا عنهم، وأيضا كان عارفا وعالما بحياة الناس، بما يقع من مشاكل سياسية وما إلى ذلك، ولم يأخذ مبدأ السلامة وعدم الخوف في هذه المسائل، بل كان يعلن عن رأيه ويجاهر به ويصرح. ولعل قضية قتل نظام الملك من الباطنية نبهته على خطر هذه الفرق الباطنية في الإضرار بالأمة، و يمكن نقول اليوم هذه الباطنية هي نوع من التنظيمات الإرهابية السرية.
Sheikh continued that in the year of 485 after Hijri, a major incident occurred in the life of Imam al-Ghazali. His patron, Nizam al-Mulk, was assassinated by a deviant sect, al-Batiniya. Al-Batiniya assassinated Nizam. Thereafter came the wazir appointed after him was Yusuf ibn Tashfin, and he put a general edict, a general order, that all the evil or all the bad rulers and the deputies should be removed from public office. And this is very perceptive for us in that we should understand that Imam al-Ghazali was fully involved with the rulers, fully involved with the situation of his time and the political situation of his time, and he was aware of the lives and the dealings of normal people, in that he attended to and was involved in the life of normal people, and in addition to that also he used to give advice to the rulers and call them to establishing the law of Allah. Now we can deduce from the death of Mirza al-Mulk, this must have enabled Imam Ghazali or alerted him to the danger of these secret groups and sects. And this must have also enabled him to realize the danger which these groups pose, not only to the Muslims generally, but also to the rulers specifically. If you want to use maybe modern terminology, which I've mentioned, maybe we could call them, you know, secret terrorist cells or groups during that time.